Reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
At that time Jesus said to his disciples, "When you pray, do not heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do. For they think that they will be heard for their many words. Do not be like them. For your Father knows what you need before you ask him. Pray then like this. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
My dear brothers and sisters in Jesus Christ, Lent is a training period of the soul, perhaps. It's kind of a boot camp wherein we train ourselves to truly celebrate the Paschal mystery of Christ, the resurrection of Christ, where we become one with him. And as part of our practice, there are three pillars that our Lord reminds us right on the day, on the first day of our journey on the Ash Wednesday. It is how to fast and to do penance, how to give in terms of almsgiving. And the third important pillar that Jesus teaches us is how to pray. And today, perhaps, the Lord reminds us the true meaning of prayer. Prayer, as he helps us understand, are just not words to please God or to placate God, to get what we need from him. It's just not a moment when we express all our needs to the Lord and make sure that he gives it to us. But primarily, prayer is a relationship. And therefore, as he goes on to teach his disciples the way to pray, he gives us a model to pray. It is not just a formula that we could repeat over and over again, but rather it is an attitude that he asks us to recognize and to put into practice. It is a relationship. It is a template which defines who we are and who God is to us. And that's why he begins his prayer by addressing God, the heavenly, the creator, the one who's the source of all good, the one from whom we all came from, in whose image we are created, as our beloved Abba, our Father. And that's the first thing that he wants us to know, that when we pray, we recognize God as a loving Father. And we know that right through Jesus as try to explain to us what is this relationship all about. It's not about a father who stands out there, but rather he's a father who comes to you, who's ready to love you and to express his love. And right through he says, pray to your Father. You are human beings and you know how to give good things to your children. How much more your heavenly Father in heaven, when you pray sincerely, will give what is most needed for you. That's the kind of Father Jesus introduces us in his prayer. Secondly, he recognizes that prayer is all about God. When we come in the presence of God, the focus is not on myself. The focus is not on where I am right now, even whether I'm in need or in desperation or even in sin. That's not the focus when we come to God. The focus is always on God, in his mercy, in his love, in his faithfulness, in who God is. And therefore, that's why he says, when he says, "Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name," the first aspect of prayer is to recognize who God is and give him glory. And then when we recognize that it is in seeking His kingdom that we find true meaning to who we are and why we are here, the purpose of our life, and all that we are facing, our circumstances, our existential reality. And that's why Jesus would teach His disciples when He says, seek the kingdom of God and His righteousness. First, seek the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things will be added unto you. Matthew chapter 6, verse 33. And that's the key. The moment we have our attitude right, our perspective, our disposition in the right direction of seeking God's kingdom, things fall in place. And that's why we pray, Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. That's why Jesus came to the earth, that He may teach us to live a life of heaven. God came down from heaven to earth so that He can take us to heaven. Our lives may be transformed to the kind of life that is heavenly, that is where we are in conformity to the will of God. And then He goes on to teach us how to place our needs before God. He says, He warns His disciples right at the beginning, don't think that God does not know what you need. He knows it. But the moment we express it, we show our dependence on God. That's the key. It is to accept that we are in need of God. And that's why we say, give us this day our daily bread. And when we are praying for this daily bread, we are not just expressing for our physical need. We express all that we are as human. Our physical need, our psychological need, our social needs. All that we are, our spiritual need, we place before God. And God, who knows what is our need, our bread, He gives it to us. But yet, in order to receive this well-being from God, one more aspect is very crucial. As much as it is a relationship with God and myself, it is also a relationship with myself and with my people, with my brothers and sisters, with my neighbors. And therefore, Jesus adds this in His prayer. Forgive us our trespasses. Forgive us our trespasses. That is asking God, Lord, let my relationship with You be set right. How? As I forgive the sins of those who have trespassed against Me. We cannot forget that. And that's why Jesus, in His commandments, when He was asked which are the greatest commandment, He would not stop after saying, worship God, believe in God with all your heart, mind, and soul. But He would add then, love your neighbor as yourself. Loving God does not stop in loving God alone. It clearly includes loving our neighbor. Receiving forgiveness from God surely includes giving forgiveness, offering forgiveness, and accepting forgiveness from our brothers and sisters. And therefore, at the end, He would conclude, pray that you are not led to temptation. That as human beings, we make journey along, but it is again the grace of God that helps us journey in the right direction. And God is there like the good shepherd, holding our hands and walking us in the right path. What a profound prayer. What a profound attitude to really enjoy this wonderful relationship with God as our loving Father. And that's what Lent is all about. To set our relationship with God, with self, and with one another right. And perhaps there's no better way to express it than this whole prayer that Jesus teaches us today. As we come to the altar, let this prayer not only be those words that we repeat over and over again, but rather let it become a lifestyle. Let it become a template for our life as we journey along, so that when we come on that day, holding our candles and professing our faith on that Easter vigil, we may be able to say, God is my loving Father and my brothers and sisters, in peace with one another as we worship as a Christian community. Amen.